does this look familiar to you? If so, you have just experienced pay to win. A phenomenon where paying real-life money on in-game objects allows you to have a considerable game advantage over those who do not pay. This can usually lead to a frustrating experience for players, but the companies do not really care because they are drowning in money, which is unfortunate for the community. This may lead to emotions such as sad, disgusted, and angry. But angry people are capable of many things. And in this case, in the most popular video game of all time, a movement has recently begun. The anti-pay-to-win movement. A movement seeking to shut down pay-to-win Minecraft servers by force, gathering a lot of momentum, despite many attempts to silence them. But how did this all begin? And what will happen next? Today, we will be taking a look at the great Minecraft anti-pay-to-win war. And it all begins on around 2010. Minecraft began as just another fun experiment made by Notch, which borrowed ideas from his favorite games. The game itself was looking pretty basic, and single player was pretty boring. So he decided to try putting multiplayer mode in the game. Players could now play together on public servers hosted by other players. Do you want to show the world the stuff you build without fear of getting trolled by trollers? Freedonia is the place to go. Do you want to show the world your builds but also get trolled and griefed and hacked on? 2B2T is the place to go. Do you just want to chill with friends and stuff in a survival world? Rent a dedicated server then. Do you want to do parkour? Not sure why anyone wants to do that, but there's a server for it. And then the game blew up. It was the multiplayer experience that made Minecraft so memorable for many players. Multiplayer was one of the most important parts of the Minecraft experience, and the best moments of the game come from time spent with friends. And Mojang realized that. However, these multiplayer servers do not come for free. Owners have to pay the price of hosting them, so some owners pay money out of their own pockets to keep them from shutting down. However, some owners pay money out of other people's pockets. Some servers have a donate option. But that doesn't really encourage people to give you free money. So some server owners decide to offer a reward for giving them money. And this is where it all goes downhill. While some servers give you cosmetic perks in exchange for money, other servers think that players need a little more encouragement to pay money. And thus, pay-to-win on Minecraft was born. Pay-to-win in Minecraft is where players pay servers for a game advantage on the server. This may come in the form of server ranks with overpowered perks, or overpowered loot boxes with overpowered loot. Game advantages may include being able to break certain blocks while others can't, flying in areas you're not supposed to, the ability to teleport to anyone and kill them, massive in-game wealth that is otherwise impossible to achieve through legitimate means, overpowered gear that can survive the wrath of 1,000 players who did not pay for perks, and more. People who pay real-life money to gain these things then have a big advantage over those who don't want to pay, which is quite frustrating, which may drive many new players away. However, some players have the need to win at everything, no matter the cost. And kids, which are the main group of the Minecraft player base, were more easily exploited for money than older people, which the servers took advantage of. So, many players began spending tens or even hundreds of dollars on servers for the juicy game advantage. There was a problem with this, however. Kids aren't rich. They have no money. So a lot of these dollars come from a source called mom's credit card. And these aforementioned mothers were not so happy to see their children spend hundreds of their dollars on Minecraft. So Mojang began receiving some angry emails, with parents asking for refunds from servers hosted on multiplayer Minecraft. Okay. Maybe not some. It was a lot of emails, so much, that Notch lost track of them. This was becoming a real issue. So Notch was now at a dilemma. He knew that multiplayer was a very important part of the Minecraft experience, and that servers relied on players to feed them money so that they wouldn't shut down. But he needed to get rid of pay-to-win so that people would not spend their life savings in Minecraft and possibly ruin their life. pay-to-win servers were never allowed in the first place, and they have been against the EULA since around 2011. They just never enforced it because they were too busy with other stuff. But now, Notch was ready. On June of 2014, a statement was released on the Mojang's website. "Hello. We love multiplayer. But multiplayer server, not free. Server owner must pay. But to get money, players might be exploited. And we want to prevent that. You can charge money for access to server. You can accept donations, sponsorships, and cosmetics. But you cannot sell items that have a game advantage, or sell on-game currency for real money." So basically, they had just announced that any income except for pay-to-win is acceptable. Now you would think that this would solve everything. But this is where it all goes downhill. People began reading the EULA after this announcement. The problem was that it was a bit vague. The EULA stated that any attempts to make money from Minecraft were not allowed, which went against the Mojang post stating that anything was fine except for pay-to-win. As expected, people became mad, very mad. People began accusing Mojang of preventing servers from making money so that people would spend money on Minecraft Realms instead, with people even saying that Mojang is worse than EA Games for squeezing money out of other people. Which is just a theory. Many Minecraft server owners began worrying about paying their bills. Supposedly, Hypixel lost up to 85% of their income while trying to conform to the EULA. Other server owners, who were a bit more stubborn, created the hashtag SaveMinecraft movement on Twitter, which somehow blew up. The Minecraft community was in flames. And then people get over it within a few weeks. In the end, nothing really gets done. There is no news on how the EULA is being enforced, and no pay-to-win servers seem to be shut down. Stopping pay-to-win would be trickier than just making an announcement on how the EULA exists. Some people believe that this drama was one of the reasons Notch decided to sell Mojang to Microsoft and stop developing Minecraft on September 2014, just 3 months after the situation. He simply could not handle all the attention. Now you would think that Microsoft would attempt to tackle the pay-to-win situation. But they seem to not know it exists. After the acquisition of Minecraft, development of Minecraft-related games begins. Minecraft Story Mode aka Door Simulator. Minecraft Dungeons. Minecraft Earth. Minecraft itself gets a few updates, with the 1.17 update looking kind of sexy. But are you noticing a pattern? None of these seem to help enforce the EULA. Indeed. After 2014, nothing was really done about pay-to-win servers. And pay-to-win server owners soon realized that they could get away with pay-to-win pretty easily. Which was exactly what they did. More and more pay-to-win servers were popping up in all possible directions. And servers that were originally fair, began to convert to the ways of pay-to-win. Many Minecraft players begin complaining about this. Was the EULA even being enforced anymore? Has a single pay-to-win server gotten punished yet? No matter the answer, it was too late. Pay-to-win was everywhere. Punish a pay-to-win server owner, and two more will pop up in his place. That's probably an exaggeration, but you probably get what I mean. There was no stopping the money-hungry server owners now. Speaking of owner, we absolutely owned 2 NFG and subscribers. The next goal is to own the I Go By Lots of Names channel. Can we pass it in subs? Please subscribe. Anyways, back to the documentary. 2B2T is full of interesting people, and Salcy1 is one of them. At the time, he and another person named FitMinecraft were doing this activity called server crashing. They would find several small servers, preferably with trash CPUs, and then put them on a hit list. Then they would boot up the YouTube stream and tell their audience to visit the server hit list and attempt crashing them. This is usually done with spamming, abusing server features, spawning entities, and so on. And then they move on to the next server. A lot of them were innocent servers which were innocent. But sometimes, they would unknowingly stumble upon a pay-to-win server. And some people had an idea. What if they diverted all of the crashing to just pay-to-win servers? So they tried that. On October of 2019, SalC1 was going to knowingly, purposefully, stumble upon pay-to-win servers, and crash them. And the suggestions began flowing in. Recommendations for more servers to crash. Methods to crash pay-to-win servers. And more. Many people liked the idea of crashing pay-to-win servers specifically, since neither Mojang or Microsoft really succeeded in punishing pay-to-win themselves. This was a good opportunity to cash out on. And so, this would not be the last time YouTubers tried to take down pay-to-win servers. Before, pay-to-win servers only got trolled once in a while, with stuff like this only rarely happening. But this is where it begins to pick up. One of Minecraft's biggest movements in recent history had just begun. But of course, taking down a pay-to-win server would be harder than just crashing it once on stream. An actual plan was needed. And it was going to be time-consuming. Most of the times, pay-to-win servers are targeted by destroying its economy. And what better way to do this than to dupe and distribute stuff? Which was going to be easier said than done. But on May 2nd of 2020, it was done. One of the first videos on destroying a pay-to-win economy was released. SalC1 and some friends decided to go to TreeMC, a server that sells this stuff for real money, and began duping and distributing. The result. The owners didn't seem to care much, and server business goes on as usual after a few hours of downtime. But the movement gets a lot of publicity. Even more suggestions on how to ruin a server. Overwhelming support. And many people wanted to have some fun as well. And one of these aforementioned people was The Horizon. But first, a bit of backstory. 6 years ago, in a server named Mine Heroes, Horizon and a friend decided to do some gaming. This gaming led to them becoming the richest players on the server. And then, the owner decided he needed some money. So the owner decided to add more pay-to-win features. Which led to Horizon getting kicked out of number one by several randoms who paid money. But things were still manageable. Barely. Until they stumbled upon a guy who spent $2,500 to gain 800 Iron Golem spawners. So as you may expect, he was not very happy. And he had enough. In his words, "O Sal-sama, we shall carry on your legacy." Which he did. 4 days after the world record for getting banned from TreeMC was achieved, The Horizon, a group of players who were investing in the anti-pay-to-win movement, released their first vid on destroying a pay-to-win server. Which would not be the last. Several other YouTubers also got involved. The Dupe Trooper, Timam, Jama, Cereal with No Milk, and more. All of which began doing a little trolling on pay-to-win servers. And people really liked that. A little trolling turns into a humongous amount of trolling. Snapcraft, Happy Hug, Complex Gaming, and more, had their economies bent by a bit of duplication. And while duping is one of the main ways to destroy a pay-to-win server, there are many other ways to use. Building a giant volcano that covered the spawn area to barbecue everyone. Which nearly worked. Creating a ginormous lag machine with the sole purpose of lagging. Jama was basically grinding out crashing pay-to-win servers. Videos like these begin popping up everywhere, and they were gaining a lot of traction. There is a problem with this, however. The owners of the server don't enjoy it. These guys were making the server unplayable and players were going to quit, which means less money. So it was time for retaliation. Most pay-to-win server owners react in several ways. The server gets put into lockdown and an investigation occurs. Everyone involved in ruining the server gets permanently banned. A rollback happens to get rid of all the damage. Several issues are patched. And a few owners decide to remove their pay-to-win features to avoid further harassment. Which was the good ending. The good ending was achieved by a server called Chili2Crafters, who took down their pay-to-win features after this video came out. But the good ending is quite hard to obtain. In an act of defiance, most server owners just move on and continue extracting money from children. Some owners even make their servers more pay-to-win. And for payback, Instead of the pay-to-win people coming to the server was going to come to them. There have been several times that server owners get revenge. Discord is a great way to gather people around a common cause. And there just so happened to be a few anti-pay-to-win Discord servers. A few disgruntled Minecraft server owners have attempted to get these anti-pay-to-win servers terminated, which worked, by the way, several times. It is up to interpretation whether using a Discord server to target pay-to-win servers is against the TOS, but anyways. This is where things got spicy. One incredibly upset server owner even offered to give loot crate keys to people for mass reporting videos that showed their server getting griefed. And the report reason was terrorism and hate speech. And supposedly the owner only communicated through laughing emojis. Interesting. What's more interesting is that after this incident, the owner did a complete 180, took down his pay-to-win features, and decided to support anti-pay-to-win. Talk about a redemption arc. After many terminated Discord servers and accounts, the Horizon decided he had enough. So he escaped to Reddit, creating a Reddit page for anti-pay-to-win. And a new communications website similar to Discord was created, for those who wanted to live chat. And they couldn't get terminated as easily. The thing is, we may never know the intentions of these pay-to-win server owners. Some of them are just greedy. Some of them are trying to feed the family. Some of them try to get their siblings into college. Which has happened with a few IRL traders on Skyblock. There has even supposedly been a Skyblock player who macroed and IRL traded as his job so he could feed his family. Wrong things, for the right reason. But the war must go on. The anti-pay-to-win movement was only growing in numbers. But the thing that wasn't growing in numbers, was the number of usable dupe methods. In response to all the pay-to-win server videos, most of which showed how dupe methods work, developers quickly patched the methods. Most dupe methods are only shown once before becoming unusable on most servers. But it doesn't stop there. Some dupes only work on certain servers using certain plugins. Some dupes only work if this. Some of them only work if that. But more importantly, most of them just do not work on most big servers. Public dupe methods that work on most multiplayer servers while tens of people are online are pretty hard to come by. Only one such method can be found every 3 to 4 months. So it was time to get cracking. The Horizon put a $150 bounty on a dupe method that would work specifically for pay-to-win servers. But it is unsure how many dupes have been sent since then. And of course, just like how Minecraft's EULA might have ruined a few innocent servers, the anti-pay-to-win movement was not perfect as well. Perhaps one of the most controversial things the anti-pay-to-win movement has done, are the attempts to take down the biggest server in Minecraft. Hypixel Skyblock. Hypixel Skyblock is a bit of a touchy subject. Ever since the introduction of gems in September of 2020, the community has been split on the subject of whether the game is pay-to-win, or not. People still argue about it today. On the other hand, it is nearly impossible to take down the economy. With tens of thousands of people playing every day, trillions of coins already in circulation, tens of plugins preventing exploits, and a system that automatically tracks and bans people with duped coins, most attempts to ruin the economy don't leave a dent on the game. The thing is, due to the huge amounts of plugins, custom items, and lag on Skyblock, there were many different ways to dupe stuff and attempt to deal damage. Keyword. Were. Many people wonder if Horizon will attempt to take down Skyblock, but here is a spoiler. He won't. He says that while people may still be pressured into buying coins, there are worse servers to target than Skyblock. There is no competition in Skyblock, so you can't exactly win. Skyblock is basically PvE, not PvP. It's not pay to win without the win. So in his opinion, Skyblock is only half bad. But for some people, it's still bad anyways. So in his place, several others have attempted to destroy Skyblock's economy. Before backpacks were heavily nerfed, the Duper Trooper decided to try Skyblock. By try, I mean, dupe 8 billion coins, distribute the aforementioned coins, and get several people banned automatically for having duped coins. And this was only the beginning. Around February and March of 2021, a few more people who were also interested in ruining Skyblock's economy, decided to do a bit of trolling. And after several dupes involving backpacks and server crashes, multiple failed patches, and billions more of coins created, what was the result? Skyblock business just goes on as usual. Combine this with the controversial nature of Skyblock's pay-to-winness, and you have several angry people who question whether this was worth it. And one of the biggest sources of dupes, which were backpacks, have been nerfed to the ground. It is unsure whether there are future plans for attempting to take down Skyblock. While it is still arguable whether Skyblock is pay to win or not, there was an issue with some over-enthusiastic people who were targeting servers that weren't pay to win. There are a few people who mistake a regular server for a pay to win server just because they didn't like a certain thing about that server. So they make requests to target that server. There are some pay-to-win servers who realize the error of their ways and convert to free-to-win, but still get targeted by members of the movement who don't really know much about what is really going on. To prevent this, standards had to be made. And they were made. A document was released to clarify a few things. And servers were categorized into not pay-to-win, semi-pay-to-win, and definitely pay-to-win. With the movement only targeting those that were very pay-to-win. In fact, organization is something that the movement is working on at the moment. And players who are interested in joining are being organized into small groups to target pay-to-win servers together. But while the Minecraft player base is gearing up, Mojang has been doing a little trolling on their own. Supposedly, Mojang has secretly decided to come back to enforcing the EULA. Several years ago, Mojang secretly added a server blacklisting feature, where players were not allowed to connect to certain server IPs, due to them violating the EULA. Attempting to connect to a blacklisted server gives the error message of, "Network is unreachable." This blacklist was easily bypassed, however. But Mojang is back for more. This has not been mentioned at all in the 1.17 patch notes so far, but server blacklisting has been updated. If you try joining a normal server in 1.17, it would say outdated client. But if you join a blacklisted server, it would instantly disconnect you. With the same exact error message that was given in the previous server blacklisting wave. Which could be a sign of something else going on. But that's just a theory. In fact, a Twitter account has been made documenting all the servers being blacklisted. And there has been a lot of recent activity. But anyways, back to the player base side of things. You might be wondering, how effective is this anti-pay-to-win movement? And what is the future of this movement? So far, only a few pay-to-win servers have gone back to free-to-win. And in most cases, pay-to-win servers are intent on staying pay-to-win. It is also getting trickier to destroy pay-to-win servers. Do not let the number of uploads fool you. There are many failed raids in between each video that gets uploaded. Some servers are going dictatorship mode, with one server censoring any mention of SALC1, and another server trapping all new players in a cage for the veterans to throw eggs at. But at the same time, anti-pay-to-win server strategies are evolving. YouTubers are planning months ahead of time, building dupe stashes months before distributing them so that server rollbacks won't affect the stashes, allowing for players to distribute again and again. And with YouTubers actively recruiting people to join the movement, the anti-pay-to-win movement probably outnumbers those who decide to stick to pay-to-win. Which includes server staff and players who seek to protect their investment in the server. The movement only continues to grow. But the future is uncertain. Will the movement grow so big and raiding happen so often that most of the pay-to-win servers are forced to stop to avoid harassment? Will the movement gain the attention of higher-ups in the Minecraft development team? Or will the movement die out, after being drowned out by the hundreds of pay-to-win servers with money and developers on their side? Only time will tell. But anyways, this is the tale of the great Minecraft anti-pay-to-win war. Shout out to the channel members. And congratulations for watching the entire video. Unless you want to watch some other entire videos. Goodbye.